Bibles in your hand, we're going to Matthew, the first book of the New Testament, the second chapter. Praise God. I just want to read two verses in your hearing. Amen. Very familiar passage in Scripture. Obviously, we're talking about the Christmas season. Amen. How many of y'all know that it doesn't matter how many times you visit the text, God has something more for you that you didn't get the last time?
Amen.
Amen. The word doesn't change, but you and I change. We're in a different place. And so every time we visit it, the Holy Spirit has a way of taking us to a deeper level.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
In our understanding of His Word. Yeah. The 11th verse of the second chapter of Matthew reads, "And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh." Again, "And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh." The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to our God. You may be seated in the presence of our God. I want to talk to you from the subject, the first and greatest Christmas gift. The first and greatest Christmas gift of all. Praise God. Christmas is that time of year when nearly everyone's thoughts turn to gifts and giving. It is also true that Christmas means different things to different people. Amen. For many, there's some confusion about its significance. From shopping to Christmas cards, it's easy to get lost in the details. Amen. A woman went to the post office to buy stamps for her Christmas cards. She said to the clerk, "May I have 50 Christmas stamps?" The clerk asked, "What denomination?" Sure. The woman responded in alarm, "God help us. Has it come to this?
My God.
Give me 6 Catholic, 12 Presbyterian, 10 Lutheran, and 22 Baptists." A mother said to that one of the proudest moments of her life was when her young son had the role of a wise man in the Christmas play. When it was his turn to speak his line, he stepped forward wearing a bathrobe and a paper crown and announced, "We are 3 wise men, and we are bringing gifts of gold, common sense, and fervor." Different people have a different take on Christmas.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Marilyn Anderson asked the question that so many others are asking, why celebrate Jesus? Why celebrate Jesus? And before I get into that, I certainly want to suggest to you that when the wise men came to see the baby Jesus, they brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. I'm not going to spend a lot of time as we investigated and visited that on previous occasions, but gold because Jesus was a king. Amen. He was the king, and gold is symbolic of kingship. Amen?
Amen.
frankincense and myrrh because Jesus was not going to have time for his body to be embalmed at his crucifixion.
Right.
Frankincense and myrrh were used to prepare the body after death. Many of you all know that when Jesus was crucified, they had to take him quickly down off of that tree. Because the Bible says, curses anyone that hangs on a tree, and the Sabbath day had come, and so they had to get his body down. They didn't have time to prepare his body, and so they bring it at the first instead of at the last. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Why celebrate Jesus? Jesus was born in a stable in an obscure village named Bethlehem. He grew up in another obscure village known as Nazareth. He never traveled more than about 200 miles from his birthplace. He was not known beyond Nazareth until he began his public career. And that public career only lasted 3 short years. His profession, prior to what he called his life calling of saving men from their sin, was a carpenter. During his life, he never ran for a public office, yet hundreds of millions have followed him over 2 millennia. He never wrote a book, yet hundreds of thousands have been written about him.
All right.
He never became the patriarch of a family, yet untold millions consider themselves his children. From the time he began his public ministry, he never had a house. He was never formally educated, yet he confounded the most brilliant sages of his time. He never commanded an army, yet his teachings have captured the hearts of mankind for over 2,000 years. In short, none of the characteristics associated with some of the greatest men of history, such as Ramses, the great pharaoh of Egypt, Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, Cyrus the Great of Persia, Alexander the Great, Julius Caesar, Napoleon, Frederick the Great, Charlemagne, etc., have been associated with Jesus. So the question again arises, why celebrate Jesus? Many people are just as confused about what Christmas is all about. So allow me to help set the record straight. God, our Heavenly Father, gave the initial Christmas gift on the very first Christmas ever celebrated.
Right.
God never gives anything less than the best.
Yeah. Yeah.
I got 2 amens that the whole church should have said something. When God gives gifts, he only gives the very best.
Yeah.
And you know what God did with that first gift? Since he couldn't give any gift greater than himself, he wrapped himself in the likeness of sinful flesh and came down to earth. The name Emmanuel means God with us. Hallelujah. And so he came down to earth and he came in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. James 1:17 says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variances, neither shadow of turning. The Apostle Paul, with deep gratitude for God's Christmas gift, wrote, thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. 2 Corinthians 9:15. 700 years before that gift was unwrapped, the prophet Isaiah said, unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given. That prophecy was fulfilled in the words of that blessed text, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Hallelujah. Oh my goodness. Aren't you glad that he came?
Yes.
Praise God. Dr. Curtis Hudson said ample evidence of the fact is of enormous sum of money spent for Christmas gifts each year. Every year, people spend a lot of money on Christmas gifts. And just as I've told you all in times past, don't go in debt over Christmas gifts. Amen? Some people are going to spend so much money around December 25th that it's going to take them 2017 and beyond to pay for it. Praise God.
All right.
I am of the opinion that if a person needs something, you shouldn't have to wait until December 25th to give it to them anyway.
Amen.
Amen. If somebody needs a coat, it's cold, give it to them now. Amen. If you want to put December 25th on it, that's fine, but let them have the name. Amen. So we, you know, every day ought to be Christmas. Every day we ought to be giving. Amen. We ought to live in a perpetual state of giving. Hallelujah. If I see my brother or sister in need, I don't need a date to bless them. Amen. You ought to be a blessing whenever the blessing needs to be blessed to that person.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Romans 8:32 states, "He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?" Salvation is the gift of God.
Amen.
Say that after me. Salvation,
salvation
is the gift,
of
God.
God.
And that's a gift that keeps on giving.
Amen.
Because if you ever taste and see that the Lord is good, the Lord is going to bless you over and over and over and over again. Amen?
Amen.
You know, God's gift is not like some of the gifts that you're going to find under that tree. And let me just say parenthetically, I want to help somebody because I've been through this. Before you buy a present, especially for kids, you need to find out how many batteries it's going to take to run it. Amen.
Amen.
One toy might take 8 to 10 batteries.
Amen.
You spend more money on the batteries than you spend on the thing that it is supposed to turn on. Amen.
Amen.
Then the other thing is, check how many parts you're going to have to put together. One of the worst things in the world is to wake up on Christmas morning, have somebody open up a present, and it's going to take you until New Year's to put it together.
Amen.
Oh, especially if you're mechanically challenged. Amen. I'm trying to help somebody. I'll never forget, Toby, I'll never forget this. I was in Atlanta, and we were putting together, it was a little kind of thing, it goes around in circles a little. You can put the kid in and they can just go in circles and everything. And I got my stuff together, put it together, and it didn't work. Everybody's eyes are on me, including my grandkids. And so I said, you know what, something's defective in this thing. And so I said, so tomorrow I'm going to take it back. And I did. I took it back to Toys R Us, and when I got there, they said to me, there's nothing wrong with this toy. I had put it together. It took me a while to get it together, because, you know, whenever I put something together, it's going to be straight.
Right.
It's going to be tight. It's going to be right. Put it together, everybody waiting for the kid to get in it and everything, and it didn't work. I said, it didn't work. I put it together. It didn't work. They said, It didn't work because there was a lock underneath it. How come didn't nobody tell me this? Who put the lock on before it even got put together? I mean, if I take my time to put it together, I don't need a lock. So I'm waiting all Christmas for them to enjoy the toy, and it didn't work because of the lock. Here's the other thing. Don't go by the picture on the box to try to put it together. Read the directions. Trying to help somebody now, because inevitably this is what's going to happen. You're going to say, oh, this is easy. You're going to put it together, and at the end you're going to have parts. And you're going to ask the question, what is this for? Now some people will say, ah, we don't need that.
Amen.
And it will never work. Because they put everything in that box. Because it works for some reason. Amen.
Amen.
And so pay attention. Listen, the word to the wise. Oh, what peace. We all too far. Oh, what need is. Oh, my God. Glory. Praise God. Salvation is the gift of God. The scripture says in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. As we think about God's glorious Christmas gift, let's consider that it was a few different things, and I want to give them to you on this morning. Number one, it was an unsolicited gift. It was an unsolicited gift. It wasn't man who saw his need and asked for God's help. It was God who saw our need and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sin.
Right.
That word propitiation simply means that God dealt with the whole of salvation through his son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Salvation was not an afterthought with God. The Bible says concerning Jesus that the Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world. You find that in Revelation 13:8. That means that before there was a malady, God had already had the remedy.
Praise God.
How many of you all know that God doesn't have to wait till you make a mistake to have the cleanup
on
our head?
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, my goodness. Sinners are pictured in the Bible as lost sheep. The scripture says, all we like sheep have gone astray. Isaiah 53:6. It was while we were yet sinners that Christ died for us. Romans 5:8. So this gift that God gave to us, he gave it unsolicited. We didn't ask for it, but God knew we needed it. I don't know about you, but I'm thanking God every moment of every day for salvation. I'm thankful that he looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. Hallelujah. Not only is it an unsolicited gift, but it is an unlimited gift.
Amen.
Some department stores cater only to the very wealthy. The gifts they offer for sale are so expensive that the average person can't even purchase them. Some very poor families are unable to enjoy gifts that are enjoyed by the middle class of society. But God's Christmas gift is unlimited. The blessed promise in John 3:16 is for everybody. It's for whosoever. Aren't you glad that you fall into that whosoever crowd?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that it has nothing to do with how much money you have in your pocket?
Thank you, Lord.
Doesn't have anything to do with how much intellect you have in your head.
Lord.
It's for whosoever.
Yeah.
So since you fall in that whosoever crowd, it's for you.
Amen.
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 Jesus Christ was God's gift to the entire world.
Amen.
No one, no matter how poor, is excluded. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Yeah.
And Hebrews 2:9 plainly states that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man.
Mm-hmm.
In the last great invitation found in the Bible, hallelujah, our Lord opens the door as wide as he can by saying, "The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears, come. And let him who is athirst, come. And whosoever will, let him take up the water of life freely."
Amen.
Revelation 22:17. Not only is it an unsolicited gift, it's not only an unlimited gift, but it's also an unspeakable gift. The Apostle Paul said, "Thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift." 2 Corinthians 9:15. Rest assured that God never gives anything but the best. Hallelujah.
Yes,
I've already told you that every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of light, in whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Jesus Christ is God's unspeakable gift.
Amen.
He is beyond telling.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness. He is indescribable.
Right.
Amen.
He is inexpressible. Hallelujah.
Right.
Perhaps Charles Wesley was thinking of this unspeakable gift when he wrote, "Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumph of his grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name."
Yes, sir.
At the name of Jesus,
yes.
Demons tremble.
Yes, sir.
At the name of Jesus,
all right,
mountains will get out of your way.
Yes, sir.
At the name of Jesus,
yeah,
one of these days every knee,
yeah,
is going to bow.
Yes,
and every tongue,
yes,
must confess,
yes,
that Jesus,
yes,
is Lord to the glory of God the Father.
Yeah.
Other words, what I'm trying to tell you is, when you say whatever you got to say about Jesus, there's more to be said.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He's more than what you can even imagine.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
That's why we got to tell the dying world about Jesus, because he's the best thing,
yes,
that's ever happened in our lives.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Not only is he an unsolicited gift, an unlimited gift, an unspeakable gift, but he's an unchanging,
yes,
gift.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Unchanging gift. Hebrews 13:8 declares, "Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, mm-hmm, and today, and forevermore."
Right.
How many of you all know that times change?
Yes.
Styles change.
Amen.
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 I'll never forget when I was a young boy, my grandfather had some pinstripes, and they were the wide pinstripes. And I was thankful, John, that they weren't my suit. Not only that they weren't my size, they just didn't look good to me. But time brought about a change. And the more things change, the more they stay the same. Guess what happened to them pinstripes? They came back in style. And when I became a young man, I found myself wearing pinstripes. Hallelujah. I got some shadow stripes at home right now. Amen. It had a way of coming back around.
Amen.
But times change, styles change, attitudes and taste change. History and magic. change.
Right.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Have y'all tried to help y'all's kids with math?
Yeah.
Listen, I was in Atlanta with Kyle and Kendall, and they were being homeschooled. And when I saw the math that they were doing, I didn't walk, I ran. In the opposite direction. I had no clue. No clue. Because they don't do 2 plus 2 is 4. 4 plus whatever. They don't do that anymore. They got a philosophy behind math. Amen? And I just rather speak with my stuff. Because it's been working for me for a long time. Amen? But math changes. Amen?
Amen.
Nearly everything we know changes.
Amen.
But Jesus Christ is God's unchanging gift.
Amen.
His perfection demands his immutability. In other words, he can't change.
All right.
Tell you why he can't change. Because you can't change perfection.
Right.
Amen. Perfect is just perfect.
Right.
Amen.
You can't improve upon perfect.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I got some good news for you. God loves you with a perfect love. That means that nothing you do can make him love you any less.
Right.
Now don't test him.
All right.
Amen. You ought to be doing the best you can.
Yes, sir.
But God still loves you.
Right.
Can I tell you something? You're not here this morning because you've been good.
Amen.
You're here because God is perfect.
Right.
Because he loves you with a perfect love, and he gives you a perfect invitation to come, hallelujah,
amen,
and taste and see that he is good.
Amen.
He's an unsolicited gift. He's an unlimited gift. He's an unspeakable gift, and he's an unchanging gift. Hallelujah. Can y'all remember the Christmas gift that you all used to get years ago? Those gifts have become obsolete. But Jesus is always current.
Right.
He's always new. Mm-hmm. Do you know what the Bible is called? It's called the living word.
Yeah.
It's not the stagnant word. Because every time you go to it, you can get something fresh and revitalized. Amen?
Amen?
That's why I like to visit the Word every day. Because every time I go back, God's got something to say to me that's going to help me in my journey.
Amen.
Sometimes he reminds me of things I already know, but he gives it to me so pretty. Until I say, God, you good.
Amen.
In fact, you better than good.
Amen?
Hallelujah. God never changes. He's the same today to those who trust him as the Savior, as he was to our grandparents. He's the same as he was 2,000 years ago.
Right.
We enjoy the same Savior and salvation that Spurgeon enjoyed.
Yes,
that Whitfield and Billy Sunday, hallelujah, enjoyed. That Martin Luther King enjoyed.
Because
he's the same.
Amen.
He doesn't change.
Amen.
Amen? Not only that, he is an undeserved gift.
That's right.
An undeserved gift.
Yes.
The very fact that salvation is a gift indicates that it is undeserved.
Amen.
Amen.
Right.
If it is earned or deserved, it is no longer a gift.
Yes.
You know, a lot of people, the reason why they can't get saved is because they think they got to buy it.
Yes.
Or they think they got to earn it. They don't think anything is of value that's free.
Amen?
Some of you all are just like that. Amen? If somebody calls your number and say, I got something for free, you want to hang up. Because you've been conditioned to believe that nothing of value is free. But guess what this gift does? It cuts against that ideology. Because salvation is free. And it's so free until all you got to do is just open up and receive it. You don't have to earn it. receive it.
Amen.
Amen.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
It is undeserved. Praise God.
Amen.
Salvation is wholly of grace. You know what grace is? God's riches at Christ's expense.
Amen.
It is God's unmerited favor. I thank God every day for grace and mercy.
Yes, you
did.
Amen. That's my posse.
Amen.
Those are my homies.
All right.
Those are my running boys.
All right.
Amen.
Right.
When I think I'm by myself, sometimes I just look to the left and goodness is on one side.
Yeah.
I look to the right and mercy's over on the right side. And I look behind and grace is there.
Yeah. Right.
I'm surrounded. I am encapsulated by the goodness of the Lord. David said it like this in the 23rd Psalm. He said, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And one of these days I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord. For by grace are you saved, through faith. Yet not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Hallelujah. That's Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. And then, it is an unclaimed gift. An unclaimed gift. You know, if I work and earn some money, and then I go out to the store and I purchase something for you, I take my time and get a box, real nice box. I get some wrapping paper. Sometimes I wrap them over here. I got seals. put a bow on it. Put a card on it. Write it, personalize it with your name. Bring it to you. You put it under the tree and never open it up. How do you think that would make me feel? How would you feel? Especially if it was a gift of God. That you have labored, you thought enough to give something that was very precious and the person never Many people have made a sacrifice to purchase Christmas gifts for the ones they love. These gifts are wrapped in beautiful packages and laid under. And by the way, this cured me about gifts. Because I would buy gifts and I'd spend a whole bunch of money on boxes and wrapping paper. And I watched my kids tear valuable wrapping paper and boxes up, and there was more money on the floor than what was in their hand. Oh, I wish I had a witness. I said to myself and to God, something ain't right with this. Amen. We're going to do something different. Now, you do what you want to do in your house. But as for me and my house, we're going to get one gift. Praise God. They're wrapped in beautiful packages laid underneath the tree. Excitement builds as Christmas Day approaches. And those who have made sacrifices are anxious to watch as loved ones and friends open Christmas presents. But it would be sad to imagine that after sacrifice and expense, some gift is unclaimed, some package is unopened. That's what God did. God sent us the very best gift that he could find. He sent himself. And wrapped himself in the likeness of sinful flesh. He came all the way from glory to claim you. He tabernacled here for 33 long years. He went through abuse because he loved you. He was spat on. He was mistreated. He was betrayed. He was homeless. Foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but no bread does the Son of Man have to lay his head. He went through scourging and ultimately crucifixion just to get to your house with a bow on it. It would be tragic today if you never opened God's gate.
Amen.
If you said to God, you know what, thanks, but no thanks. You want to know why some people are going to end up in hell? It's because God has given the very best gift that he knows to sing. And there are people who think that they can live their life without God. Who think they can make it all by themselves. And God is saying to all of us, I'm here. I'm there.
Yeah.
Try me.
Yeah.
You'll like me.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Yet the greatest gift of all, God's Christmas gift, Jesus Christ, is still unclaimed by millions. I'm closing with John 1:12, which says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. To believe is to receive. Repeat this after me. To believe is to receive. If you don't receive, you don't believe.
Amen.
Amen. The Bible word believe means to trust. It means to depend on. It means to rely on. To receive God's Christmas gift simply means that one must admit that he is a sinner.
Yeah.
Believe in the gospel story that Jesus Christ was born, that he lived, that he died, he was buried, but on the third day morning, he got up with all power in his hand. If you can believe it, you can receive it. Hallelujah. And trust him completely. Hallelujah. We know that the Lord has given us a great gift, the greatest gift he can give. We ought to trust him.
Yes.
It's one thing to come to worship and raise our hands and say hallelujah. That's all good. We ought to do that. But the greatest hallelujahs and the greatest praise the Lord are not going to be in here.
Amen.
Can you say hallelujah, praise the Lord when the rain is descending?
Come on. Right.
Yes, sir.
Can you say hallelujah and praise the Lord when life is contrary to you?
Yeah.
Can you say hallelujah and praise the Lord when folk are lying on you and digging ditches for you? And in spite of what the devil has meted out to you, you say, I can still say.
Yeah. He's worthy. Yeah, he's worthy.
I can still lift holy hands.
Yeah.
I can still say praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Because Jesus is the best thing that's ever happened to me.
Yes.
I've searched all over.
Yeah.
Couldn't find nobody.
Nobody.
I looked high and low.
Yeah.
I still couldn't find. There's nobody greater.
Yeah.
He's a gift that keeps on giving.
Yeah.
Try it.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.